Antoine Perrier is the speaker.
Hello, thank you, François, for inviting me to present 10 years of my work. So I will present you the... I made the slide in French for Philippe, and I will speak in English. So, sorry for the French. It's a teamwork, and I have the chance to work with a lot of teams, biomechanical teams, hospital teams, but also more fundamental, like the Museum National d'Histoire Naturelle. And all those teams, all those people are giving some idea and help me to go further in the modeling. But first of all, as a clinician, we need to be sure that it is not because we know all the pieces of a system that we know how it works. And we need to remember that, because otherwise we will go in sometimes a wrong direction. So it's not because I know all the parts and I am able to name them that I know how it works inside. And the question is, what is the primary goal of this system? If a foot is a system, what is its primary goal? Or a spine, for example. And for that, we need to answer this question. How those structures that allows these primary goals are working? And if we have a disease, how it adapts in order to keep the function, and then how we can help the system to keep working. So when we deal with neuro-orthopedic patients, it's another difficulty that's coming around. So we need to be careful. Structural anatomy, all the pieces, is not functional anatomy, how it works, and it is not biomechanics, how it is computed. It's, you need really to understand that, otherwise you will do shortcuts. So what is biomechanical modeling? What is biomechanics? You can have in vitro biomechanics, which are the analysis of the stress constraint inside structures, for example. You can have in situ, like gait analysis, for example, where you try to compute what happened inside a system. But you also have in silico modeling, and in silico modeling is like the future of evaluation. It's already the case for pharmacological, but it is how it can be computed on a processor and how we can predict using model what are the constraints inside the system, the deformation. In France, the eye health authority say that we need to use a standardized patient in order to simulate a clinical situation. There is also an European law that make in the teaching of medical students and also biomedical students the obligation to have in silico knowledge. That means that in the future, all the people that will go through studies, medical studies, will have to learn what is in silico studies. And the FDA now is, does approval of a medical device based on simulation. So first of all, what is a standardized virtual patient? So for that, we use medical imaging, like CT scan, like EOS, X-ray, but also MRI in static, full body, or in dynamic, in different position, but also we can have different analysis, like tractography, and also a low-dose system, like the CONBIM, for example. For creating a model, a virtual patient, we need all those information. And thanks to that, we will extract the morphology, the 3D shape of the bones. We will extract the 3D shape of the muscle, for example, but also we will extract clinical parameters, a 3D point regarding some specific anatomical insertion for ligaments, muscle, and other specific parts. Once we have that, we need to think how we can model the system. So this is an example of what I call translational biomechanics. We go from what is the functional anatomy, what are the idea for the clinician. And so often we resume the foot as this kind of system. But in reality, the repartition of force are really more complex, and passively, all the bones are going to distract and to change their position passively due to the weight of the patient. There is a good system in functional and structural anatomy, which is called aponeurosis. So we need to learn how this aponeurosis work, and for that we need to be sure how it functions regarding the different position of the bones and also the position of the foot regarding the legs. Once we understand, for example, that the aponeurosis will change the trajectory of the muscle, will change the coaptation of the bones, we will be able to understand what is the goal of this structure. And for example, the aponeurosis will passively make the toes go in plantar flexion, and with this system, we will increase the surface, and because the weight is not changing, if you have the same weight and a more surface, you will have a lower pressure, for example. And it is passive. So once we understand that, we are able to modelize. So what you see here is modelization, direct dynamic. You don't have ideal joint. It's only the shape, the contact, the ligament based on the MRI that create the motion. So we spent the last 10 years to validate and evaluate this kind of modeling. So here is the most recent works on the spine. So we have modeled all the muscle and ligament in the thoracolumbar part, but we begin with the foot and also the lower limb. So this is a modelization, and for that we combine multi-bodies, but also finite elements. Once we have that, we need to validate. And for that, we did a lot of validations, thanks to Didier Pradon, for example, for the foot. And we perform EMG. We perform foot in loading position. But we also perform MRI with MRI-compatible device in order to have the deformation in the soft tissue. And thanks to that, we were able to implement, for example, EMG, that does not occur as a force, but it occurs on activity, and we can put the EMG inside the modeling in order to see what would happen with these specific bones and structures in terms of motion. We validated the knee regarding the cartilage constraint, for example, but also regarding the strength of the muscle. And finally, we validate what's inside the joints, for example, the meniscus and the cross ligament, using dynamic MRI. So here, you can see a full-flexed simulation of the meniscus and cross ligaments. And for the spine, we are currently validating that regarding two different positions. And for that, we need to go through registration. So this is how we make a standardized virtual patient, but how it can be the digital twin of the patient, how we can do personalization of this kind of modeling. So for that, we use the imaging as an input, and then thanks to mesh matching to registration, we are able to transfer what is inside the virtual patient into the shape of the specific patient. And then we are able, for example, to pilot the real CT scan and to create virtual CT scan in different positions, but we can also extract clinical parameters that could be useful. Then we validate this anatomical transfer, and this anatomical transfer, which is automatic, is more robust than an inter-observer transfer. So what are the applications? We are now trying to understand how we can use this kind of modeling in order to predict, how to make hypotheses about some results. So we are currently using this kind of modeling in order to predict what could be for a specific patient the impact of the position of unicompartmental prosthesis for the knee, for example. And we will track the patella, for example, we will track the length of ligament. But if we want to go regarding deformation, we could also see what is the impact regarding the collateral ligament or the cross ligament. Or if we want to go through materials, we could see what's happened regarding this specific patient on a specific loading on the component of the of this unicompartimental prosthesis. Our idea now is because for the moment a surgeon chooses one position and he doesn't know how it would work for another position. But the techniques, the guideline says you need to put in this position. For me, in the future, I think it won't be acceptable to have a definitive surgery without testing virtually the other hypothesis. So it's an assumption, it's an opinion, but for me, it's reality. And how we do that, for example, because you can have different positions of a specific implant regarding varus valgus, regarding anterior position, or the size, we are now able to do a matrix of simulation. And if our question is regarding, for example, the patella tracking, we could see for this specific patient, with the hypothesis of a specific law for the soft tissue, we could see what will be the impact for these parameters. Or if we are considering the collateral ligament, we could see the impact of this position regarding this parameter. For example, if the clinician says, okay, for me, I need to have the lengthening of those ligaments that are parallel in a curve, we could do that output and say, okay, this position would provide you what you are expecting in terms of ligament, for example. So we also did that on a real patient with Laure Gatin and Philippe de Normandie for diabetic foot, because we are able to monitor the constraint, and because the wound of a foot is regarding the deformation, we are now able to compute what is deformed upon 50%, for example. And thanks to that, we could see if a medical device like foot arthrose could help the patient, or if it is not possible, how we need to cut the bone in order to go into a lower deformation. We also did that in order to understand some failure regarding transfer. So here you have a tibialis posterior muscle, and this muscle is transferred on the basis of a metatarsal. And we can check for the specific shape of the bones what would be at least the tenodesis effect. We won't be able to predict the function because for the moment we are not able to predict the function, but we can at least see for this specific shape of bone what could be the motion. But because it is definitive or like an arthrodesis, we also need to know how the foot will work with the other muscle activation once it is blocked in a position. So we did some evaluation regarding the function of the dorsal flexor muscle and with and without arthrodesis. And we compare and we saw that some muscles that are full dorsal flexor became abductors. And so it can explain for some patients how sometimes, even if the surgery is well done, the patient is not able to be inside his foot when he walks, because when he keeps the reflex to go in plantar in dorsal flexion, he has an abduction that is not controlled. We also did this stimulation in order to understand what happened regarding the triceps tendon pathology. And for example, this was done with Romain David. He will speak after. And we did this simulation in order to understand why this specific patient was not able to have a good recovery of his tendon. And the simulation shown us that this specific shape of calcaneus, this specific shape of talus, create a minimum 5 degrees of dorsal flexion. This means that he is not able to have more than 5 degrees plantar flexion, dorsal flexion. And when he is in this situation, it creates a deformation of the bone, but also a big traction on the tendon in order to be able to keep doing his motion. So it helps us for the moment more for the comprehension of the function. So we can now make some hypothesis about the place of specific structure. For example, you can see the role of the aponeurosis, the long plantar ligament, and we can also see if this ligament is not present, what could happen. So it helps us to understand, for example, in a Charcot fit for diabetic patient, why we have this dislocation in plantar. It also helps us to understand, for example, what is the stability of the knee during the flexion in open chain, and it gave us some parameters like the direction of the force, for example. We also can test just the action of one muscle, for example, the tibialis anterior, or for example, the fibularis longus, and because, as the precedent orator said, it gives a verticalization of the first ray, we can explain or simulate for a specific shape why it will create a varus of the infoot. And we are now going through the comprehension of specific muscle contraction regarding the spine. And here you can see a simulation of just one quadratus lumborum contraction. And so we are now doing parametric simulation in order to understand a specific mobility for a specific muscle. To conclude, we also use that to do more fun stuff with Bernard Parat. So we had the chance to do some specific examination on non-human primates in order to understand how they work. And we did this kind of simulation. And thanks to this simulation, it leads us to specific dissection in order to understand why they have different stability. And thanks to those simulations, we are able to target specific, for example, metatarsal joint, and so that the baboon, for example, have sesamoid in every joint. So to conclude, modelization is a simplification. So because it is a simplification, we need to be careful about what we see. The visualization can be make us wrong. So to be able to use the modelization, we need to validate it with experience. It needs to be developed with the clinicians that are specialists of this discipline. It needs to be patient-specific, the shape of the patient, the position of the muscle of the patient, and it needs to be confronted to reality to have a good evaluation. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Antoine.